Welcome back to the Views from the Gravel Lot podcast. This is episode 18. Following week one of the NFL season, the Bills took down the Arizona Cardinals 34-28. Lots to get into, lots to talk about. First, I want to introduce my co-host, Trent Curtis. How you doing today, Trent?
It's been a day before I go on vacation here. It's been a good week for me. The Bills won. Tried to kill me in the process, but they won. And the Jets embarrassed themselves on Monday Night Football. So, great week.
That's always a good one. Always good when the Jets lose.
Even 85 Bears, my butt.
I know. We might get into that a little bit later because we know how you are about the Jets. The Bills did beat the Cardinals. And like you said, it was one of those games where it's like, what the hell, man? And so we're going to go jump right into it and go into the key takeaways. And there's really a lot to digest in this game, to unpack. There's a lot of layers to it. But I wanted to start with something that was on my mind immediately when it happened in the game. I'm going to go on a quick little rant here, so just bear with me.
Oh, boy. Oh,
refs.
God.
The refs.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
So I'm going to sit back and enjoy this.
Not good. Not good at all.
No, those refs sucked ass.
I don't even know where to start. Like, obviously, Kyler Murray, it's a third down play. He rolls out of the pocket. He runs. He doesn't pick up the first down. Drive ends. It's fourth down. And Jamarcus Ingram, as Kyler slides down, braces himself. He barely touches Kyler. You'll see the video. He barely touches Kyler Murray. And it's like,
what are we doing? Touched him.
I mean, what are we doing here? And then the same game, Josh Allen gets tackled with the hip drop tackle, which we've been just absolutely pushing all offseason, how the NFL wants to get rid of this. And they want to eliminate that part of their game. They give these quarterbacks hundreds of millions of dollars. I get it. You want to protect them. But have some consistency. Have some fairness. They weren't doing that.
You know what's funny, Ben, is I watched a Monday night game, and I think it was one of the wide receivers for the Niners, like Juwan Jennings. I think it was he got hip dropped and no penalty either. So maybe it's just one of those like fictional rules, like they put him in there just to get someone to shut up.
I don't know. Like, that's my thing. It's like, you know, these refs need to be held accountable at the end of the day. Like the NFL, you know, these players, you know, these fans pay a lot of money to see these games, and that's a swing of 4 points. That Kyler Murray play, because you're talking about instead of getting a field goal, the Cardinals end up getting a touchdown because it extends their drive. And yes, the Bills won the game, but the refs are now putting their hands in the game. And that just, to me, ruins the integrity of it. Like, there's always going to be plays that are going to be negated with penalty or whatever. I get it. But when it's blatantly obvious like that, the refs are now controlling the score. They're having their hand in the game. And for me, it's really upsetting. And it shouldn't happen. It's been a problem that's really gone on for many years now. And I know there's a lot of fan speak and fans like to say, oh, you know, we get screwed by the refs, this and that. But, like, really, it applies league-wide. It's not like just one team experiences and another one doesn't. It happens. And there needs to be a level of consistency. And like I said, these refs need to be held accountable. I'll kind of let you go, Trent. I don't know if you have anything more to add to that, but that's my first takeaway. I wanted to just kind of jump right in with that because, you know, we were at the game. We saw it. The fans were not happy. There were the ref chants.
We were up there watching the game of Ralph Wilson and Dale Earnhardt, and we could see that.
Ingram
didn't touch him.
We didn't need binoculars. We could see that.
We didn't need binoculars. I could see the gap between them. I mean, I understand, like, I get it. You don't want the game to be lawless, but, like, I feel like we've been calling too many damn flags on everything. Because, like, you see a big run, 85% of that line is holding.
Yeah,
like,
for sure.
Holding's only called if it's on the edge or if it's blatantly obvious. But then if you're going to call Kyler Murray basically not getting hit at all, and you're not going to call Josh Allen getting hit on a slide as well, and then the hip drop. But then you give a roughing the passer because some poor corner's trying to tackle Josh Allen because he just jumps on Josh Allen. That's roughing the passer. And God knows how many false starts Spencer Brown and Deion Dawkins had, and just it's not fun watching
Yeah.
flags.
It's not. And it feels like this year in general, like I saw it in the games I watched the Ravens and Chiefs game and the Eagles and Packers. Like it was a flag fest, just absolutely insane. Like more than I can remember. Like there was tons and tons and tons of flags just being called at a ridiculous rate. So
It feels egregious because a lot of the pe I feel like now the general public knows a little more. I feel like refs are trying to like cover their asses. The problem is that unless you, because no football play is ever perfect. There's the saying goes, there's holding on every play. There's a penalty on every single play if you look for it. I'd much rather it go dial it back, like call less penalties.
Right.
Call Don't call a penalty unless it is so
Let them
blatantly
play.
obvious
Yeah.
that it hinders the actual game of football being
Yeah.
played.
And back to the holding call, like I think you made a great point. It's like they'll call a hold. I saw a holding call where the player's being held, but the player's already 15 yards down the field. It has no correlation with the play. Like you need to make sure that the penalty you're calling has a direct impact on the outcome of the play. And that just doesn't happen. It doesn't
It
happen at
shouldn't
all.
be, yeah. It shouldn't be a penalty because that's what drives me mad about some of these illegal formation penalties that they like. Oh, we're cracking down against that, and the Chiefs' right tackle jumps offside every single play.
Yeah, I
I
know.
mean,
It's insane.
it's literally the Legion of Boom mentality of, well, they're not going to call pass interference every single time they throw the ball, so I'll just
Right.
pass interference. But refs weren't the
Yeah.
only thing that drove us to drinking.
Yeah, I know. So, I mean, there's a lot of positives in this game. Let's start with Josh Allen. Always usually a positive for the Bills. I think the biggest takeaway for me was like very efficient mistake-free football. I know that the Bills schemed a lot of guys open, but you know, for a guy that's mocked for his turnovers, he can play that style of football all day long if he wants to.
I mean, he gets mocked for the turnovers
He
because
does.
he. Hell, I was watching. I saw a clip of some this morning. Somebody complained about the fumble, which again was really stupid. That was peak like week one. Josh Allen's going to do
Yeah,
something
sugar high.
fucking stupid,
Sugar high,
and
Josh.
he ran from a clean pocket. Like he could have just rolled out left, got 8 yards. He rolled right into Spencer Brown's guy. To the point, Spencer Brown's guy never got off Spencer Brown. He just took his hand out and whacked the ball
Yeah.
out of his hand. Like, it was
He
like,
put
what are you doing,
himself in harm's
Josh?
way. Yeah,
But
but that
then,
was like probably the only thing. That was
oh,
the
yeah.
only, I would say, like, I don't even think he had
That
a turnover worthy play besides that.
and throwing the ball into Ty Johnson's feet was
Yeah,
annoying, but
that was, but that
watching
I
some
feel
other
like those are,
quarterbacks, yeah.
if those are going to be your only two misses, I'll take that any day. Like for as good as a game he played, if those are the only two blemishes you're going to have, that's a win. You'll
Yeah.
take that every day.
I
Yeah.
think he had like four or five incompletions and
Yeah, he was,
only one that
I believe
yeah.
he started the game on a huge completion streak. Like he was really, he found a rhythm early. And you know, I mentioned on the previous podcast episode previewing the game that the Cardinals are going to play a lot of off coverage, which was what they did, and they kind of let Josh dink and dunk down the field. They didn't really give him anything over the top. But like I said, you know, Josh is willing to play that game. He's a mature quarterback. He's, you
And
know,
to the credit, they didn't really run a whole lot of stuff down the field. I mean,
no,
everyone
no.
found that one clip of Keon basically pulling free, but like there is not a soul around Ty Johnson.
Yeah,
Josh puts
yeah.
that like near the two and the six, it's a first down instead of it being a Tyler Bass field goal. I think it was Tyler Bass field goal. Yeah, that could have been third first down and then eventually Tyler
Yeah.
Bass field goal. But no, Josh
Yeah.
Allen, I know in the past we've gone on this show and we've been like, well, I don't want Josh Allen to be the focal. Well, guess what? You watch the Chiefs game, you see who's the focal point of the Chiefs? Patrick Mahomes. You see who's the focal point of the Ravens? Lamar Jackson. Josh Allen's going to be your
Offense
focal.
runs through him. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you see what happens. We have a quarterback that can't do that. Watch the Bengals game. They lost to the Patriots.
Yeah.
The Patriots suck. They're not good. And they
No.
lost.
That was an
They're
odd
missing
one.
T. Higgins, and that now you lose.
Yeah. Rough
Like,
look for the
Johnson's
Bengals.
gonna lose this game just simply because the defense couldn't stop the common cold for a little
And
while.
the special teams and Matthew Smiley just forgot how to tackle. So, yeah.
I mean, to be fair, Matthew Smiley wasn't out there, and Todd Bass
Yeah.
was the only one trying to tackle. So I'll
We're gonna
give
blame
Todd
him.
Bass credit. But
Speaking of that though, like the offense, it was interesting because I think I have a lot more confidence in the offense than I did before the game. In the receiver core and the playmakers around Josh. And here's why. Dalton Kincaid was completely taken out of this game. I'm sure you've maybe have seen the video. There was five Cardinals defenders surrounding him at one point. They made sure he was not getting involved in this game. I mean, credit to him, he's probably the Bills'
My
best
fantasy team
playmaker.
really wishes he did.
I know. I think he had like 2 points or something. But for the fantasy football people and the people fans watching, he's gonna be just fine. The looks will open up for him. And it starts with Curtis Samuel getting more involved in the offense. I believe he was dealing with an injury. It's quite clear they didn't utilize him to the full extent. He was, I believe, fourth in snaps for receivers. So that's very telling. And the money they gave him, he's not going to be the fourth receiver on the depth chart. He'll be fine. They're just kind
Matt
of.
Collins was an important part of the Bills' offense.
He was, and he was good. Let's get into it. So, like, I think it's a testament to the Bills' depth and kind of the ceiling they can have because it's a game where, Curtis Samuel and Dalton Kincaid really weren't involved, but they still went out and scored 34 points. And, obviously Josh Allen has a large hand in that. Probably, I mean, that's basically most of it. But I mean, like, I think you're able to showcase that you're able to spread the ball around and you don't necessarily need to have this alpha number one wide receiver to succeed. I think the Chiefs were an example a little bit last year. I know you have Travis Kelce, but in terms of having that number one receiver on the outside, like, I don't think it's completely necessary. Like, the Bills are kind of
Yeah,
trying that experiment out.
you don't need the game-changing number one if you have a whole bunch of good number twos with
Right.
bang
Yeah.
the condition.
Yeah. And I think, like, especially in today's age where you're giving quarterbacks $50+ million, Josh is going to be making north of 60 in his next contract. Like, you're not going to want a receiver and just taking up that much of your cap. It's like the Bills are basically asking themselves, well, do we need to spend big money on the receiver this offseason, or are we content with just rolling out a bunch of dudes? And I think that the Bills and Josh Allen and Joe Brady proved that they don't need that number one guy. They can spread it around. And that was one of my biggest takeaways because I felt like there was really no intention to just force feed somebody the ball and revolve your game plan around him, and you kind of just naturally flow with the game, and it really benefited the entire offense. I'm not sure how you feel about that. I wanted to sort of get your
I
opinion,
mean,
like.
yeah, because like you talk about flow, that was a big part of it, was that like it felt like the Bills had 2 minutes of possession in the first half, and
Yeah.
like it felt like, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
Once they we're gonna you know what, screw it, I'm gonna get to this right now. Since we're talking about flow of offense, Joe
Okay.
Brady, if you watch this, please stop running the ball on first down.
First down. Oh my
Please,
gosh.
I
Thank you. Thank
beg
you.
you,
They knew
stop
it
running
every
the.
time. Every
You,
time.
everyone in the grandstand, everyone's mother in the grandstand, everyone's grandmother in the grandstand, everyone around the damn country is watching that game, knew what the Bills were on first down. And we were at the game, so I don't think TV covered this. When Alec Anderson entered that game, the Cardinals put in like five run stoppers in the game,
Yep.
whose
Yep.
only intention was to stop the run.
You'd see them sub the big boys right on. You knew
Yeah,
those. You
it was like
saw
a
those
big boy
350 pounder
package.
boys just running.
Yeah,
Yeah, you.
this brought all these damn big boys on the field as soon as
Yeah.
he came in. With 70s eligible, as soon as he came out the field, the big boys followed him off. It was like, oh.
Yeah, like that's I think he'll have to learn as he goes on. Like you have to break tendencies.
It's
You
not
have
even
to not.
hard.
It's
Josh Allen's
really
one of the
not.
best play action
It's
quarterbacks
not.
in the NFL.
It and that's I think my biggest concern with the offense, they didn't tap in that as much as I wanted them to because I feel like play action is probably our biggest strength when teams have to respect the run and the pass. And like you said, like those tendencies, it was very obvious what they were doing. And you have to be able to mix it up and change things up throughout the course of the game and not kind of just run the same thing over and over again. It's very obvious to say that, sit here as a fan to say that, but it's not that hard. It's really, you got to be able to be multidimensional not just be the same thing every time on first down. So I completely agree with you.
Yeah, we're not a service academy where we can just run the ball down
I
your throat.
know we're
I
not
know they
running
really
triple
wish they
option
were.
for the entire game, which I have been doing with
Cover one had a stat thing. I
UB
don't know if
in
you
college
saw this,
football.
Ben, but cover one, yeah, me and kind of college football. Triple option, baby. Cover one had a stat. UB. The Bills ran that inside zone play like 11 times, 10 times was on first down. At first half, it worked, and then the Cardinals were like, hey, wait a minute. They're not throwing the ball when Alec Anderson's in the game. Why are we defending the pass?
Yeah, and I also think like part of it is you're going in the second half. James Cook's not necessarily a bigger back. If you're gonna run that kind of inside zone, inside trap, I'd like you to use Ray Davis in that situation a bit more, sort of somebody who can kind of take on contact and push forward for more yards, because that's not really James Cook's game. He can certainly win in between the tackles, but I just don't think he's going to give you those additional yards after contact that Ray
No.
Davis might be able to offer you. So if like you're going to do that as much as you have, at least give yourself a different back in the game.
I
You can
agree. Ray
certainly try
Davis,
it with
Ty
James Cook.
Johnson,
I would like you
teach
to
Reggie
just at
Gilliam how to
least,
run the ball.
yeah,
Try
I mean,
somebody.
yeah, like I just I wasn't in love with their game plan on the ground.
I'm not gonna
It will
lie to you, the
grow, it will get changed.
I did like a lot of facets of the run game. It's just like
Yeah.
line up in shotgun and do that. You could put Alec Anderson in the game when you're in shotgun and you can
Yeah.
still run the ball. You got to do something. You
Yeah.
can't just basically tell the defense, hey, we're running this play. You are not the Lions. You are not a service academy. You cannot run the motherfucker over play every single down. You can't do it. You're not, you invested the money in Josh Allen. That's what you invested your money in. You
I
said, this is what we
think
are.
he had two completions at the 2-minute warning or something
Oh,
crazy like that. It was
dude,
insane. I was
yeah,
like, what the hell? Why are we throwing the
like,
football?
we haven't had the football.
Gosh.
Josh Allen's not throwing it. We were losing 17-3. I told the buddy I was with, I was like, man, we kick a field goal. I'm calling an Uber. I'm going home.
Yeah, we're leaving.
But
One
yeah,
more
we could get
thing.
into that. That
Yeah.
defense, man. I don't think that if we had to
Well,
hire that defense for first half security, there'd be 90,000 people in that stadium.
One more takeaway I wanted to add on before we move on to our next segment. Is Keon Coleman. He went for 4 for 51, a very solid game for a rookie. He was pretty high among all rookies in terms of receiving yards and target share and routes run. He played the most snaps out of any Bills receiver, so the notion that he's not going to see the field kind of died early on. The fact that they're willing to trust a rookie in week one to play as much as he did shows their confidence and faith in him. And I think, Keon showed some nice things. I'd like him to work on some of those,
Didn't do an
yards
end
after the
around though
catch.
for a touchdown, Ben. That means it was a bad pick.
I know he didn't have two catches, right? So he's a terrible player. He didn't have two catches for 20
Didn't
yards.
the Cardinals didn't blow the coverage on him. That means
Yeah.
the Bills screwed
So they're
everything up
terrible.
again.
They're terrible. Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly how we're I can't stand that whole discourse. It drives me nuts. But
listen, all those other teams could have traded with the Chiefs too.
thank you,
Like,
Kansas City, for Keon Coleman. I appreciate that.
yeah, thanks for the extra cigarette. Thanks for the extra stuff. I appreciate it.
So I wanted to go and dive into the play where Keon had that big catch down the sideline. And
Oh,
this is the perfect
beauty.
example of what
Beauty.
they want Keon Coleman to be. This is Keon Coleman at his best right here. Running down the field. And by the way, side note, it was an absolutely perfect ball from Josh. Couldn't have put it anywhere better. Absolutely perfect. You don't
Can
want
tell that
Keon.
old the old boy worked on his mechanics in the off
Oh
season
yeah.
because
Oh yeah. This guy, I'm very curious to see like what the efficiency numbers are gonna be this year. Like, is he gonna have that year where he only throws like four or five picks and shuts everybody up? Because that would be fun.
listen,
But
I would he keeps feeling like this Lamar's going to get a third MVP, man.
yeah, probably. I mean, yeah, he'll throw for 1,000 yards and run for 1,000, and he's got it in the bag. Anyways, Keon Coleman, the perfect
Tyrod
example of
Taylor,
what you want him to
baby.
do. I've mentioned many times his ability to separate is a problem, but you can win with him deep, and here's how. Ball was underthrown, but on purpose. Keon Coleman boxed out that defensive back and essentially left him no chance to catch, to get, make a play on that ball because his physicality, his strength at the catch point, his catch radius, it's all amazing. And that's how Keon's going to win. He's essentially just going to be like, okay, I'm winning this ball. Get out my way. And
The old
that's
Megatron way of
exactly
doing
the old Randy Moss. He mossed him. Like that's the kind of thing they
it.
want Keon to do.
I would go more along the lines of like an Andre Johnson or
I like
Calvin
it.
Johnson, or even like rookie year Gabe Davis, which is what I said a long time ago. Rookie year Gabe Davis only made sideline catches.
I
And
know.
that was a beaut of a sideline catch. In fact, it was so good. Josh Allen didn't think he caught it because the very next play they ran up to the line and he put too much dip on his chip and overthrew him.
Yeah. If he puts that ball on Keon, I think he's catching that touchdown.
Yeah, I didn't really like the side note, goal line fade, probably one of the best routes ever done unless your name's Calvin Johnson. Calvin Johnson ruined
Correct.
that throw. Calvin Johnson, Matt Stafford ruined that throw for everyone else because they made everyone think that's a throw. It's not a throw. You have to beat the guy off the line first. It's a press move. It's
And
not
it's
a
also the ball placement needs to be absolutely perfect. Otherwise, the DB's making a play on the ball and it's not a high percentage play.
because the receiver's just basically like hoping that he be
And they
screwed
just
up.
essentially gotta just muscle out the it's a very difficult play. Only
It's
a
an offensive pass
select
interference
few that can do
play
it.
where you legally are allowed to assault the corner.
Essentially shoving him as far. I get what you're trying to say. But yeah, I mean, the only thing I'd like him to see clean up is the yards after the catch. He was kind of dancing around a bit, trying to do a little bit too much. But that comes with being a rookie.
I'd actually argue this with you, Ben, because there was a point,
What?
it might have been like a third down catch or like a maybe a second down catch, where he caught it right at the sticks. And a lot of receivers, when they get a guy tied up around
You
their
got what I'm
feet,
talking about.
they try to spin out, they try to dance around. Keon Coleman saw the guy was down on his feet and just dove straight forward.
Yeah, he kind of extended the
Probably
ball.
could have muscled his way out. He could have done a lot. He said, you know what? There's a guy on my feet. It's the first game of the year, and I get a first down. I'm diving forward. And that was one
I
of the
would
smartest plays
say
of the day.
that was probably the best example. The other times when he got the ball, he kind of tried to do like I, if he did what he did on that catch, more like again, he's a rookie, he's gonna learn. But we'll see. I mean, like I really like what I saw from him. Like I don't really know what my expectations are from this year. I think it's kind of just kind of learn as you go, make some plays for us. I'm not expecting him to be some superstar receiver. I don't think that's fair. I expect him to be a very solid receiver and develop into a number one wide receiver. So I liked what I saw in week one.
A little
I would
better
say you would
Gabe
agree.
Davis year one is kind of where I'm at. Like
I agree with you.
if you be
With
somewhere
more targets.
between Manny Sanders and Gabe Davis year one,
Yeah,
that's exactly where
definitely.
that's where I'm hoping he ends up.
I agree. So we'll move on here. We're going to go into our second segment, and this is the panic meter segment. So we got three players for you guys. One of them we had already mentioned, but I wanted to start out with Taron Johnson. This is more of an injury-related situation, so this isn't really have anything to deal with his play on the field because we all know how good Taron Johnson is. But it's more so how concerned are we without him on the field? Look, man, Taron Johnson, he does a lot for this defense. He's that third linebacker who's filling in for him. There's a lot of question marks. I would say, and
Up.
we're gonna go 1 out of 10 here. I'm gonna give it a 7 as far as my concern goes. Look, he's already listed as a possible injury reserve candidate. It's early in the season. It's gonna be tough. You got the Dolphins, then you got the Jags. I'm not sure who's up after that. I haven't looked that far enough out. But
Ravens.
yeah, so you get a tough slate right out the gate. You're gonna need him for those games. And especially against the Dolphins, like with the things they like to do. But
Kyrie
I don't
season.
know, man. I don't know. It's gonna be really tough. It's a forearm injury, so if it's a fracture, he'll definitely be out for quite some time.
Tape it up.
Yeah, just throw a Band-Aid on it, you know,
Listen,
like
he plays linebacker. You can play linebacker with a club. You don't need to catch.
I think it was, who was it? Mina Kimes, who tweeted that he's probably the most underrated player in the NFL.
Oh,
Couldn't agree
yeah.
anymore. Couldn't agree anymore. He
Absolutely.
just, the position itself doesn't get a lot of love because it's nickel and there's not a lot of, splash plays from a nickel unless they get an
Not like
interception.
that.
Like,
Nobody uses a nickel like the Bills do. Like maybe the Chiefs. You could argue the
I think
Chiefs
it's
use the.
starting to pop up a little bit more as far as bigger nickels, not like the
Yeah.
way he's built. I think you see a lot of, I believe the Giants are using Isaiah Simmons as their big nickel right now. So,
That's a
yeah, there's,
linebacker, man. You can't fool me.
it's, yeah, exactly.
You
So it's
that's a
very
4-3
fascinating.
defense, son. I'm gonna bust out
Exactly.
the 1999 playbook on you.
I know, right?
You can't fool me.
Yeah,
Panic
but you,
meter is
I'm giving it a seven. I'm giving it a seven.
let's put because I don't want to break my panic meter. I was listening to some talk shows across the country that their panic meters are shattered. I'm gonna put mine at 9 because
Nine. Okay. That's fair.
listen, horns up, shout out to Cam Lewis, Jamarcus Ingram.
How long can they sustain that play for? Oh, I don't know. That's a big question mark.
0 games. They barely
Yeah.
sustained for one.
Yeah, it will be
I will say
interesting.
they did a great job adjusting the second half. Kyler
They
Murray
did.
had like 30 yards
Absolutely.
passing. I think 20 of those came on the final drive. So that great job on the final
Yeah.
drive.
Bobby
The
Babbage did
first.
a phenomenal job adjusting in that game.
Yeah.
Really,
Yeah,
really
he.
impressive for a first-time play caller as well,
You could
might I
see
add.
the first half. He definitely, like, it felt very much like McDermott was just like, all right, sink or swim, buddy. Because, I mean, we've seen it before with McDermott. Like, he's yanked the playbook straight from Leslie Frazier.
Yeah.
So I'm sure he was probably thinking,
And
hey, listen.
Frazier's a former head coach, assistant coach. Like, he's got more leeway
Frazier was
than
on the
Bobby Babbage.
1985 Bears.
I mean, yeah, like this guy, he's got a much more proven track record.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah. Props to those guys, but they are not Teron Johnson. I mean, we
Taron
talk.
Johnson's arguably the best nickel in the league. Like, the drop off is already insane itself.
The
So,
position he plays is a one of one position that you like
yeah.
the Bills have tried 5 different people to replace Matt Milano and Teron Johnson.
Yeah.
So that shows you how much they're worth.
Yeah, the heavy lifting he does, not only in the pass game, but the run game as well, is just not, you're not gonna be able to replace that. But next player
The
was
closest thing
interesting.
you could do
Go.
is, sorry to interrupt, the closest thing you
No,
could
you're
do
good.
really is go back to like a 4-2-5 defense. And
Yeah.
if Mike Edwards is healthy, have him play slot. But you can't
Yeah.
do this to Fish. Fish are too fast for that.
Yeah. The next player I wanted to talk about was Osiris Torrence, who had a pretty rough game. The O-line play itself was pretty solid. I think that Torrence was probably, look, he had a couple penalties in this game. There was a few false starts. I do think they have that happen with the majority of the line. It is week one. You're working out the kinks. I get it. But
I
35.1
was.
PFF grade. He didn't look very good on film. I don't know, Trent. I know how you feel about PFF, and I know you have a very strong opinion and strong belief around it.
Tyrell Dotson
But
was the second best linebacker at PFF. We're
he
using
didn't
this
play
as a
bad,
metric.
man. He didn't play bad. He's not the second best linebacker, but I'll tell you that. But he didn't play bad. I do think the grading is the grading scale for them. It's
Josh
been
Allen
all
had a
over the place.
75 grade
Yeah,
on that thing. What was
it's
it?
all over the
75 out of
place.
75?
But
What's the standard?
my point is like he didn't show the growth I wanted to see initially. But again, like my whole so I had it down as a four. It's not extremely high. I'm not at the point where I'm like, okay, maybe we gotta start looking at other options. No, not even close. I think, when you look at the Bills offensive linemen, they have those later breakouts. Like Spencer Brown, he just got a huge contract for a reason because he broke out last year and established himself as a very solid right tackle in the NFL. Osiris Torrence can do that. He's working with a very good offensive line coach. It might just take time. So I still think he can be a good player in this league. It's probably not going to be this year.
I mean, he was a good
Time
player
will
last
tell.
year. Like,
He was okay. I wouldn't say he was like super good or anything like
Here's
that.
the thing, like a lineman, like if you hardly notice them, they're doing their job. Osiris Torrance got a penalty near the goal line. I was in like peak, like these refs suck mode, and I saw the penalty as he had like a
Yeah,
grab of the
he
guy's
yanked that
face.
face. Yeah.
Like the false start's bad. Take it as a offensive lineman in high school. Jumping as a guard is probably the dumbest thing you can do in football because you are right next to the ball and you
Yeah.
know the cadence.
Right.
So like it's a double whammy there. I'm gonna put it we'll put it at a three because that's generally my panic meter for about everyone but Josh Allen on the Buffalo Bills.
For sure.
Like I was actually gonna tell you debate about Mike this, but Mike's too busy frying
Yeah,
fish, then I
he
don't know
didn't
what
care
he's
about us
doing.
anymore, apparently.
No, we're not important enough. The first week 1-0. I got amped up before the game. I'm amped up now, and Mike's not here. I'm believe
He's not
I
here.
was gonna
It's like, what
I
kind
was
of
gonna
fan
I
are you?
was I had a whole debate ready about preseason because the first half of that Bills game was sloppy. They looked slow. They looked bad, and they did not play much of the preseason. And there's a point across the league that a lot of teams have played their starters less and less and less, and they have all looked worse and worse and worse. Like this was, like see some of the passing lines. Like Caleb Williams for 92 yards. That is Rex Grossman doesn't throw for 92 yards in 2006 football.
Yikes.
Like, and that's the Titans. That's not even a good team. That's the Titans. You telling me you can't throw for more than 92 yards
Historically
with
speaking,
DJ
though, rookie
Moore
quarterbacks
against the
don't perform
Titans?
very good. Good quarterbacks usually don't perform well in their first start, but I get what you're trying to say. Like, I don't know.
That's as
I
easy
think
of a
that
first start as you get.
I still think, you should definitely give these guys live reps in preseason, give them a chance to work out what this offense wants to do and push
You at
forward.
least need to play a quarter every game because
I do understand the second game not playing them because the weather had an impact. I get that.
that I understand.
That third game, I would have liked to see him out there. I know that they were dealing with a ton of injuries at quarterback, so I was surprised that they didn't even give Josh Allen a drive.
I would, I think, yeah, I agree with you. If you're that worried, that concerned, give him a drive and then shut him down. We talk about worries about injuries, and like I said, Josh Allen owns two houses. He could get hurt walking from one house to the other house. You could get hurt walking
He
up the
could slip
stairs of
getting
a
his
movie theater.
mail by walking a mile up his driveway, probably, but
Right.
yeah.
He could, like, if we're that concerned about
Things
preseason,
happen.
yeah, it's football. Like Teddy
And I also
Bridgewater's
think
career ended in
players
practice.
are generally taught to go to take it easy as far as hitting the physical contact goes. Like you could play with physicality or whatever. You just dial back a little bit. I think you
Yeah.
can kind of tell that that's the case in preseason. You could just watch and compare it to regular season side by side. You could tell that the speed's different. I know there's different players in and out of the game, but as far as starters go, you're not seeing.
Yeah, you
I
can
can't
also
think of the
tell
last
if like
major
there's
injury
joint
in
practice
preseason.
preseason games. You can see when it's starters versus starters, like the linemen are live reps. The corners do one-on-ones do with the receivers, but it's generally the receiver wears a red penny and a quarterback wears a red penny, and they're just like, all right. A quarterback knows the slide early. Defenders know, don't touch them. But yeah, that first half.
It was ugly. It was ugly. It was
The
really
first
ugly.
half, the panic meter was pegged at 11. I was thinking we were going to go like 3-13.
Yeah. I told Mike, I was with him at the game. I'm like, yeah, we're not making the playoffs this year. We're going 8-9. That's what it's going to be. And it's over. Totally normal heat of the moment reaction, but.
Listen, when we went over my preseason preview, what did I say, Ben?
Gosh, you have to
13 and
remind me.
4, and every game is going to give you a
Oh
panic
yeah.
attack.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. You did say that. Yeah.
We're off to a good start.
We are. So last player I wanted to talk about here in panic meter. Very low panic on this guy. And I mentioned before Dalton Kincaid. I put it at a one. A zero if you even want to do that. Look, this guy, he ran 83% of the routes. He was used in a lot of ways in this game, but the Cardinals just made sure he was not involved in the game plan. Joe Brady said in the press conference that they did everything they could to take him out of the game. The Bills worked around that. They facilitated the ball to other playmakers, and the offense benefited as a result. Sometimes you got to do that you know, in this league. And in a league where tight ends don't have a ton of success week in and week out anyways, I don't think it's right to overreact to this game. Mark Andrews didn't have a good week.
Yeah.
Sam LaPorta didn't have a great week. Travis Kelce didn't have a great week.
I was literally about to say, Noah Gray out-touched him.
I mean, it's like you can't really be that critical of tight ends because their job is a lot different than receivers and running backs where you're not getting consistent volume. Like it's much easier to take a tight end out of the game than it is to take a receiver out of the game.
Oh, yeah.
Is what I'm trying to say. So,
and not like that, if the passing game's not really flowing, right? Mm-hmm. Like, this felt like, it honestly felt very old school this week. A lot of running, a lot of defense, yeah. Not a lot of passing. And there's a reason for a long time Tony Gonzalez was the only receiving tight end. And that's just out of you didn't really have that. That wasn't really a part of the playbook, was to have a tight end that ran routes.
And it's not like you're giving tight end design looks. Like receivers, you can give them like jet motions and screens. And like, yes, you can do screens with tight ends, but it's much different than it is with a receiver where the receiver has the burst and the quickness to get upfield. So
I think one of those games, I think they ran a tight end and a fullback screen in like 2020, 2021, and I could not believe my eyes. But I said no three for Cyrus Torrance because I said that's my base panic meter. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say three again because that's my base panic meter because Dalton Kincaid could wake up with food poisoning tomorrow and we'd be in trouble for Miami. Yes. But I was a bit perturbed that he wasn't really involved, but then after seeing that pretty much Arizona's plan was Dalton Kincaid's the only guy Josh Allen will throw to and take him out of the game, and Josh Allen threw to everyone else.
And the guy still had like 230 yards, four total touchdowns, and no picks. Like it didn't really help them in the regard that they thought it would.
No.
Yeah.
Thanks for trying.
Yeah, right. Yeah, we were talking to the Jesus, the Cardinals guy on the previous podcast, and we were talking about how the Cardinals are going to have to design a lot of blitzes, and it's going to end up hurting you, and it did, I think, in a big way. Josh Allen and this drop-back passing offense really did whatever they wanted to do against the Cardinals in the second half, except with the exception of going deep, which the Cardinals took away, but the Bills underneath
really
and intermediate. Right, like
MBS was open areas, on the throw.
He was, but he just didn't lay out for it at all, which is – he has one job, MBS, for this team. And it's to be the guy to run down the field and catch the ball and be fast. And he can't even do that. Like, I don't know. I've been frustrated with him since he signed with us. So.
Week one is not the week you go diving for footballs.
Look, man.
It's not. You don't
care.
What?
I don't care if it's preseason. But, I mean, like, the guy needs to show a little bit more. I mean – I don't know. It's up to him if he wants to put his body on the line.
Yeah, it's week we'll one. See. The Bills are a three receiver, two tight end team. He is wide receiver four.
Total personnel. We'll move on now. We'll go to studs and duds for week one. I'm going to go with a stud, then we'll go to Trent's. Trent will give us one, and then we'll kind of go back and forth. Stud, I think it's very obvious to say Greg Rousseau. The guy balled out. Absolutely machine. I mean, where do I even begin? Three sacks, two tackles for a loss, one forced fumble, four pressures, six defensive stops. He was an absolute freak. And I know the Cardinals' offensive line is nothing that's going to scare you, but any given Sunday, man, like if you're putting up that kind of production, no matter who you're up against, it's impressive. It's three sacks. That doesn't happen. That's never happened in his career.
He's on pace for 51 sacks this
season. I mean, like the guy played out of his mind, and not just like rushing the quarterback. He defended the run brilliantly and the scenarios that he could. Like his length and just power is those two traits and tools he has are just absolutely insane. And I've been talking about it for a while now, and we had the discussion about, you know, maybe paying Greg Rousseau, and he's going to earn that contract. Well, he's off to a fantastic start because he played out of his mind. And I think there's a very strong case for him to win AFC Defensive Player of the Week, even over the likes of TJ Watt, because really, quite frankly, he was the best player on the field, not named Josh Allen, on Sunday. So, like, he was a game wrecker, and that's kind of what we've been hoping him to be since the day we drafted him. And much like I've mentioned with these Bills and their draft picks, it takes time. Be patient with these guys. This development process, for whatever reason, for the Bills, unlike other teams, their rookies tend to take longer time to develop. I don't know why that is. Some are,
We
but.
buy. Oh, look at. Let me give you an analogy. I want this as a one of the short in the videos.
Okay.
When Brandon Bean and Sean McDermott go to Wegmans, they're going to the cookie aisle. They're buying the Betty Crocker mix. They're buying the guy to put in the oven for 300, bake for 300. All these other teams, they go down to the milk section with those packaged Wegmans cookies. They just buy like two packs of those and take those home. Yeah, those
Yeah.
packaged cookies taste really good, but hey, listen, man, when you get one of those cookies straight out of the oven, it's all hot, kind of like
Yeah.
the
The
chocolate chips
gooey.
comes
Yeah.
apart, it's gooey, you
Yeah.
bite it, like, oh, this is the best cookie ever. Like, do you want the instant gratification of those Wegmans cookies, or do you want the nice tasty cookie that comes out of the oven? The Bills rookies are nice tasty cookies coming out of the oven. Sometimes you burn the shit out of them and you can't eat the cookie. It's a hot cup. You're like, damn, this sucked. That's diarrhea of
Yeah, I was
them.
gonna say. Yeah. Yeah.
Sometimes you put that cookie in the oven a little bit and it comes out. You're like, man, this cookie is really good. That's Greg Rousseau. Greg Rousseau's
Yeah.
that cookie.
It's funny because he showed us those same flashes in preseason. So now that's two games where we've seen he's built off that. It's like, okay, carrying this over. Miami's gonna be a big test because this is an offense that gets the ball very quick. They play in a lot of wide zone offense. It's going to put a lot of stress on him defending the outside zones and be interesting because Devon Achane or Raheem Mostert might not play in this game, which could be huge for the Bills in terms of limiting what that offense can do. Because if they're not playing, they got a rookie Jalen Wright who's coming to the game, has not played in the NFL game before, and Jeff Wilson. So it's obviously much less explosiveness. But yeah, I think he showed me in every which way, like, he can be a star in this league. And I don't think that's an overreaction. I think that's just what you saw. Like, you saw a player that went out on the field and just destroyed everything in his path. And I was very impressed. And I was quick side note, Von Miller played a good game for the Bills. He
Listen,
did.
it was one of the things I was talking about with you guys was that I truly think Vaughn should just not have played last year. He should have
Yeah.
just taken the year off, said, I'm
He
not ready
rushed way
yet.
back. I don't even know if it's that. I think he rushed back into the injury.
No,
Like,
he was still
and
limping coming into the games.
yeah,
Like, he was hurt.
he was not where he needed to be this year health wise. He's significantly better. He graded. He had a very nice pass rush win rate this week. He obviously picked up, a sack, which, it's one of those cleanup sacks, but he got a
I
sack.
mean, it was a cleanup sack because
He rushed the tackle
he literally threw the
into
tackle
Kyler.
into Kyler
Yeah.
Murray and it touched Kyler Murray. Like,
Like,
that's not a cleanup
that
sack.
shows that that's not that that he's got some he's got a lot of gas left in the tank, because that type of power, it usually you see it fade away with a lot of these older passers. Didn't with Vaughn. He really displayed it at a high level. And if him and Greg Rousseau, build upon that game, I think you're really talking about the Bills in a much different light at the end of the se at the end of the season. If you have two legitimate, really good pass rushers, it changes the whole ball game for the Bills. We're talking about it being reset year, like, oh, they're not going to be probably competing for a Super Bowl. They will be competing for a Super Bowl. If As long as you have Josh Allen, you're probably going to be competing for a Super Bowl. But I'm just saying, you have a much better chance of competing for a Super Bowl if you have those guys playing the way they did in week one. So
Patrick Mahomes had a reset year and then won another Super Bowl.
they won a Super Bowl. So I mean, it's like
So,
you can't even write these guys off. So
speaking of
Trent,
the
I'll let you
defensive
go.
line,
Give us a
yeah,
stud. Give us a stud.
a stud. All right,
Yeah.
you know what? Cam Lewis, horns up, baby.
Horns up.
I guess they had him ready to play dime corner, dime linebacker. Had to fill in. Did a great job.
He did.
He had nine tackles. That was
He
third on the
did.
team. And he didn't look out of place.
He
He's
didn't.
been their utility belt player. And you know what? On a pinch, looked great. Something I know a lot of people remember the whole Justin Jefferson thing. And he didn't swat the ball in the Lake Erie and this, that, and the other. I mean, come on. Justin
Yeah.
Jefferson used Cam Lewis to catch that ball. If you're still mad about that, be mad about the fact that Josh Allen couldn't handle a snap on the 1 yard line and nobody would have ever replayed that ever again. So, stud, Cam Lewis, shout out UB, horns up.
Nine tackles and four defensive stops.
Was good.
He was very solid. And
Boy, boy was good.
I think he in the second half, it was much cleaner in the second half. Obviously, that you had some of those problems, you know, rear its ugly head in the first half. But I think in the second half, he played very well. I think he was, besides Greg Rousseau, I think he was Bill's best defensive player in the second half. I just the way he played and handled that situation. Like, again, once again, the Bills' depth is just really, really good in those situations. And a team that's a lot of people forget, like, you know, when you talk about this defense, they're like, oh, you know, they lost a lot of players. No, they didn't. A lot of these guys were already playing last year,
like
because of those injuries, and they still were a top 10 defense. So
the safeties are a lot to be desired.
Yes.
They play exactly like we were hoping for growth. They play exactly the same way. Those are not my duds. I'll give that. You know what? I'll give that right now. Cam Lewis played really good.
Mm-hmm.
Ed Oliver, Daquan Jones, duds.
No, holy it wasn't crap, a good week sucks. For them.
Not a good week. I was about to say, you talk about running backs. You and I could play running back for Miami. If they play the way they did against Arizona, we're probably averaging 3 or 4 yards a carry. I mean, they made the linebackers look bad.
Yeah.
Like, you know how hard it is to make instinctual linebackers look awful? They made those. They made Williams and Bernard look awful.
Yeah.
Like when
they put them in some rough spots. I agree.
And, and really the big adjustment in the second half was instead of having Bernard and Williams as spies, they just sent them on blitzes, just straight up the middle,
mm-hmm.
clear the path, and Kyler couldn't throw over them. Like that was the big adjustment. Was they just sent the house every play. Like they tried to do Bernard or Dorian as a spy, and it didn't work because Kyler Murray had 8 years to throw the football.
Yeah, there was no disruption from the interior. Like, it was frustrating to watch. I remember seeing a rep from Ed, like, trying to rush. I think it was the center, Hyle Froholt, the Desert Viking, they like to call him in Arizona. And he just he showed no power, like, on this rep. And it's like, it's just he was trying to rush him, and the center anchored so well that the center wasn't moving. And it's like, those are the concerning reps for me. Like, at the end of the day, I think Ed Oliver is a very good player.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't think we should be talking about Ed Oliver in the light where he's amongst those like Quinn and Williams and the elite defensive tackles in the league. I think he's in a tier below because you don't see the consistency factor with him. Because, you know, there will be games where you'll see those plays where he's like, okay, yeah. He's got that game record ability, but he just doesn't show it every week.
It's not
and
every
that's
game.
The concerning. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
it's not just Ed. I don't want to just pin this on Ed. Did Daquan Jones get a tackle?
I don't know. I mean, I had
did Dwayne
mentioned
Carter
him
even
as
play.
Being,
was he active?
I don't think Dwayne Carter played much. I don't know
if he played at all. Like,
I'll pull up the defensive snap count, but I mean, like, I yeah,
pull
like you
up
said,
some stats here because I don't know if like Dwayne Carter even played. I don't know if Daquan Jones got a tackle. I mean, I understand some of those guys are, you know, Daquan Jones is a space eater.
I got you right here.
All right,
so Dwayne Carter played 7 snaps, 11% of the snaps. Austin Johnson, he played 13 snaps, 21% of the snaps. Ed Oliver played 82% of the snaps. And Daquan Jones played 74% of the snaps. So they really didn't do a ton of rotating. Like, that's kind of why they invested in the depth this offseason to rotate Ed
that
and kind of
give.
That's the point. You don't want Ed out there. And you using him at an extremely good, like extremely high rate, because then that takes him out of the game because Ed doesn't have the energy to rush at late in the game and use everything he has in his you know his tool bin. Like you need to be able to have sort of a relief pitcher in a sense for players like that. Even like Daquan, who's like older and climbing up in age, like you need to have someone who can step in. And I like Austin Johnson a lot. I think he's perfect for the backup behind Daquan. But you need to. I need to see a little bit more usage from your backup defensive tackles. I agree.
Yeah, that was a pitiful performance by the D tackles.
Yeah.
That's really what gave the Cardinals their game was they were able to run up the middle.
They were able to control the clock and basically have
not
those
like that,
long drives.
Also, Ben, they were able to basically spread them out because they realized the up the middle is doing nothing. So
it's funny though because I was watching some of the All-22 and. What the Bills were doing in the first half, it was just mind-boggling because the Bills, You'd be it would be so obvious that the Cardinals are running the ball. There'd be like no receivers on the field, three tight ends. And they'd have a nickel package out there. They'd have five defensive backs on the field. It's like, what are you doing?
Yeah,
Like,
you need
you
to
need to
throw
get throwing
people
some
out of the
showing the
field.
Beat Boys like what are you doing, man? Like, I get it's the first game. You're gonna work these things out, but that can't happen. You gotta have the right personnel, and you need to be able to react on the fly. They made the right adjustments in the second half. I'll give them credit for that. But in the first half, they came out and the game plan looked terrible. So props to them for the way they responded to it. But the way they started that game cannot happen again. Because if you go out and get played that way against a team like the Dolphins, or like the Ravens or the Chiefs, where they have much more explosiveness, you're gonna get
I
killed.
mean,
And
shit.
it's you're gonna be in a
I don't
position
think
where
you
you
can
can't
really
come
say any
back.
different.
Like
Like, is it
you
any
literally
different?
wouldn't be able to come back.
Hell, if
So
anything, if they're more explosive, you might have a chance to come back. Like,
yeah.
that was absolutely the worst
It
half
was
of
bad.
defense.
I honestly don't
I
think the
even text
Cardinals
my
punted the
dad.
ball in the first half.
I was like,
So
shout out to the 09 Bills for showing up for today's
yeah, I
game
know.
because.
It was rough. I'll go to another stuff. I want to go two players in this sort of a two-parter, but the tackles for the Bills I thought played very, very well against the Cardinals, Spencer Brown, Deion Dawkins. Fun fact, the Bills had the highest pass block win rate in the NFL in week one. Deion Dawkins and Spencer Brown, they did not lose a single rep on a pass blocking situation, according to ESPN analytics. That to
Even
me,
ESPN Analytics agrees with me that Josh Allen ran into Spencer Brown's guy.
I know. It's like that's the growth we want to see. Like that's great. Like that's like I think both these tackles, I feel like, offensive line, you don't get criticized too much except for tackle. Tackle is going to be a much more heavily criticized position, and the Bills were able to answer the bell very well in week one. And I know we had a lengthy discussion about how the Cardinals pass rush, it wasn't very good. But at the end of the day, like I had mentioned before, it's any given Sunday. It's hard to win every single rep in an NFL game. That
Yeah.
shows that's impressive. Like, I don't care who you're playing, that shows signs of a really good offensive line. And even a guy like David Edwards, who I know you bashed in the preseason, he had himself a pretty strong day as well.
He
He
looked
was
like an
he
NFL
tied he was
starting.
also he was also tied for first in run block win rate, I think, or it might have been pass block. It was one of the two, but he did very well as well. So,
He
and then
looked
you
like
got
an
three guys
NFL
there,
starter.
definitely.
I mean,
NFL
listen,
star. I mean, you're paying the guy backup guard money. You're not expecting him to be some world beater at the end of the day.
No,
So,
just don't be bad. He was bad
be
the
serviceable.
preseason. He was good in the regular season. So you
Yeah.
know what? If he had to work out some roughs, some kinks, if he had to get used to being the sun being shone on him, I don't know what he was doing for the preseason, but I'm glad he did because he looked like a like the best way to say how he played was he looked like. He didn't look like he didn't belong. So.
Yeah, and I think the big thing with Edwards is like if he ends up being like an even an average guard for the course of the season, you have him signed to a very cheap deal, run it
Oh, yeah.
back next year. Like 2 years, $6 million. That's nothing in today's
Even
NFL. Like
then, you
that's a
got
huge
guards and tackles lined up out of the gazoo behind him, so
exactly. Like the Bills have
plug away.
always invested very well in depth in the position behind them. It's funny, I don't think it got noticed by a ton of people, but the Bills had actually started Tylan. They dressed Tylan Grabel, the rookie 7th round pick or 6th round pick,
I noticed.
over Ryan Vandermark, which I thought was
Yeah.
interesting. And it didn't get talked about a lot because it's sort of so minor on a big game day,
Listen,
first game
we
of the
are
year.
the only show that cares about backup tackle.
Right. Swing tackle, man. It's the best position in
We give
sports.
the big boys their love.
We do. And I thought that was interesting because he played very well in the preseason. He was somebody I had mentioned in that final preseason game, showed some nice flashes with, the way he played and the way he used his hands, and obviously impressed the Bills enough to dress him on game day. And that says a lot for a team that look, Cole Bishop didn't even get dressed for this game,
No.
which I think coming up on Thursday night, they should probably dress him just because you're down Taron Johnson. You can kind of use him as that. If anybody could play that nickel piece other than Cam Lewis, he's probably the guy in terms of being able to step up into the box and make plays. And look, he's not going to be able to sustain the level of play Taron Johnson did. And
No.
I think I trust Cam Lewis to be the band-aid, I don't trust him to hold it down for the, you know, 4 or 5
I
weeks.
I trust Cam Lewis to play Tayron Johnson's spot more than I trust Taylor Rapp and DeMar Hamlin to play safety.
Right. Yeah, I completely agree with you. I feel like it's going to be a huge test on those safeties this week, like seeing what they're able to do against a vertical passing offense that has the speed that they do. Like, they're going to be stressed. I mean,
I gave Rapp and Hamlin the benefit of the doubt. I was thinking that, hey, you know, a season of them being the starters, because for all intents and purposes, they've been the starters since July.
Right.
They look exactly the same. And the problem is the two of them play exactly the same. You have two Poyers back there who can't cover, who cover like last year's Jordan Poyer did.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. When they find their target, they seek and destroy. The problem is that it's finding a target to seek and destroy. Mm-hmm. It's not making the big play.
All right.
Not bailing them out.
It's like, it's, you know, it's fine. It's the worst safety room in the league. It really is.
I'm not going to say it's the worst because I saw highlights of the Carolina Panthers and the New
York
you're Giants.
Right. Oh my god.
So
I forgot about that. Wow.
I'm not going to say we have the worst anything because the Carolina Panthers got blown out.
And that's a team Saints. I expected them to be like, you know, pesky
mid.
At least this year. Like,
just
they weren't even that. They got blown up by the Saints, who I thought. I said I went on record saying that the Saints would be the worst team in the league. They're not close.
Why did you say that?
I don't like Derek Carr. Okay, I just don't think he's.
You don't like the eyeliner, man. Come on, you got the eyeliner going on.
I don't like Sid from Toy Story. Okay, just stop.
I mean, they got Alvin Kamara. You tell me that's gonna be the worst team in football? They got Chris Olave on that team.
America can't stay healthy. Let's move on here. We're gonna go with one more dud. I'll let you go, Trent. One last dud, and then we'll kind of wrap it up here. And then I'll kind of add my last one as well. So, who you got for your other dud?
Well, I said this kind of toss up here because I've kind of said bunch of duds. I'll go based off of what we expected versus what we got. I'm gonna go Joe Brady.
Okay.
If I can sit in the grandstand on plenty of alcohol and figure out what you're running, NFL coaches who are completely sober and paid a lot of money to stop you can also figure out what you're running, and they will stop you. And they did repeatedly. How many second and 11s did they have? How many third and longs not by penalty happened? Like, you gotta switch it up. You gotta run play. You gotta run play action off of one of those runs. You gotta run. Yeah. You gotta run out of a different formation. You gotta do something. If you want to run a first down, you gotta switch up how you run a first down. You gotta switch up what you present it as. You can't line up an I formation and run the ball. You don't have that kind of team. Like, you are close to having that kind of team. You can have that type of team if you play up. You know. Matchup beneficiary like the Cowboys game, you don't have. They know you're running, you know you're running. Line up and run team. That's not what the Bills are. They are. Josh Allen controls the show, and once everyone's worried about Josh Allen running to their face, run James Cook. Like,
I think they wanted to. They wanted to do what they did against the Cowboys in this game. I think that's what the mindset they had going in this game, because they saw on paper their defensive line is not very good, still not very good. And they wanted to establish the run, but you have to do
thing,
it
though with the Cardinals is that at least they have some beef.
Mm-hmm.
Like the Cowboys had no beef. They had a dude who looked like a corner playing linebacker. Like, I'd line up with Reggie Gilliam in the backfield every play of the game until they took that dude out of the game.
They really, like you said, they didn't present it the way it needed to be presented. Like, in order to open up that run game, you need to have a passing game. That's how the NFL works. Like, you need to be able to they had two pass attempts like for like two quarters. That's not gonna help you open up a run game. And look, run numbers were actually pretty strong in the first half, but they tried to do it again in the second half, and the Cardinals were just all ready for it. So
they literally ran the same play like I thought it was the same play. You know, we sit at home, we think it's the same play. They literally ran the same play.
Yeah. And if it wasn't the same play, it's the same concept. Like it's the same personnel, same idea, same game plan.
When you insert a sixth offensive lineman, you don't do
Yeah.
anything, run the same exact play. What do you think is going to happen?
Yeah.
Like the Cardinals got good. They just started
It's
pushing
funny because
linebackers.
when they used the sixth offensive lineman last year, they had a ton of success out of it. But they were able to use it in certain situations. They didn't, you know,
Correct.
spam it like a 5-year-old playing Madden 25, you know, spamming four verticals and halfback screen. Like, no, you need to be subjective with it. You can't just no, it just doesn't work that way. It's easy for me to be critical. You know, we're two fans just sitting here at home recording a podcast, but
Like the show's called, it's Views from the Gravel Lot. We could
right.
be sitting in the gravel lot. If I hear Alex 70's eligible, I could tell you they're going to run the ball.
Right.
I don't need to see the actual formation.
Yeah.
Like that's how that game went.
It'll be interesting to see what they do against Miami in terms of that
Please,
sixth offensive lineman.
please
Yeah,
throw the ball out of
just
that. Throw the
don't do that
ball.
again. My last thought. I saw what you said earlier about this coach and Sean McDermott, and I know what we're about to get into. But just let me have my piece here, and you're allowed to add in as soon as I'm done. But I picked him for my dud of the game. I think his game management of this game was absolutely terrible. Terrible. Should not have kicked that field goal. I don't know how you feel about that. I feel like you're on the opposite side of the fence about that. But you're in a situation where he consistently does this. The Bills are up, what was it, 3 points with 2 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. It was fourth and two. Fourth and two. You have one of the best quarterbacks in the NFL, and you're 2 yards away from getting a first down. You're already two for two on fourth down, and your quarterback is averaging 10 yards a throw, and you're kicking a field goal. Like, what the hell are you doing? You're taking the game out of Josh Allen's hands again. Like, have you not learned anything from the Chiefs game? You did the same exact thing. You're just not giving him the chance to win the game. And like, if the Cardinals gonna stop, whatever. Field goal doesn't win him the game. Like, I'm sure you can look at the win probability and percentage into it, and it will tell you the Bills should absolutely go for it in that situation. And it scares the shit out of me that Sean McDermott does not put the ball in the hands of Josh Allen. He's putting the ball essentially in the hands of his defense, who have countlessly, t so many times, have crumbled in that situation. So, you know, it is what it is. It ended up working out. It was very close to not working out, and it shouldn't have been that close. But once again, he's putting us in those positions, and it's just frustrating, man. So I like him to see that him handle that situation differently. Trent, I'll let you say your piece here. But
I
that's just kind of where I'm at with
should
that.
have got some popcorn for that one. Damn,
Yeah.
man. I Ben from
Yeah.
Vegas calling in for
Yeah.
that one. Listen, it was fourth and three. It was fourth and three. It was a long
Okay,
three too.
1 yard. All right.
I mean, the way he laid it out to me made sense because they went for it quite a few times. Like it wasn't like they just said, nope, we're not going for on fourth down. Fourth and one and two, they had a whole bunch of fourth and one and twos, and they went for them pretty much as soon as they got onto the other side of the football field. So to me, I can't, like McDermott laid it out perfectly. He talked to his analytics department over the offseason. They pretty much said fourth and one and two, go for it no matter what, because you have Josh Allen. Odds are if he gets tripped at the line, he's still going to get you 2 yards. That's a
Yeah.
fourth and three is when it becomes dicey. Because if Josh gets tripped in the backfield, he's not getting you 3 yards. He's getting you two. If James Cook, it's, you know, if you miss a block, James Cook's not getting you 3 yards. He's getting you none. If you throw the ball, clock stops, whatever. If you miss the pass, which you could have done roll out on, I would have done that. But I also understand why you kicked the field goal. You kick the field goal, you go up six, you force Kyler Murray, who had at that point had 10 yards of passing, to throw the ball on you for 70 yards. It ended up being 60 yards the way it ultimately ended up. And he even said, there's no guarantee that you go for it, you score a touchdown. You could kick a field goal again
Yeah, but
and you end up in the same spot again.
there's still more time off the clock in that
Don't get me wrong,
situation, and you're using Cardinals timeouts.
I don't want to put the blame on fourth and three. I want to put the blame on everything that happened before then, because you ran the ball
well,
three
I will
straight
say,
times
I agree,
out
like,
of running formation.
The play before that,
Joe Brady, what are you doing, dog?
The Josh Allen, like, keeper was end up being, I they end up losing yards, I think.
That's
just terrible. That's a terrible play call.
Ultimately, what took him out of go for it range was the draw.
And, I don't know. Like, Tyler Bass ended up making the kick, but, you know, I don't think you're as confident with the wind conditions the way they were. You're kicking into the wind. Bass hasn't been great. I don't know. I just, I like putting the ball in the hands of Josh Allen in that situation.
No. I think, yeah, that's the thing is that I agree with you. I'd rather Josh Allen have the ball. But even in the state of mind I was, like, I was thinking, man, I wish we went for it. But, like, I understand why you didn't. Once I heard his explanation, it made sense. And that, listen, your defense has been pretty good.
Yeah.
You could make it 6 points and force them to find 70 yards somewhere they haven't had all day.
Yeah.
And it pretty much worked.
It's funny because, you know, after all that, we just talked about the offense and the defense. Special teams is probably the thing that came closest to us losing this game. Because when you think about it, touchdown, Cardinals get back into the game, and then the kickoff out of bounds, which I think because the kick didn't land in the landing zone or whatever, and it rolled out of bounds.
No, that
moved
one,
it to the 40.
Our kick, the Cardinals had a kick that didn't land in the landing zone.
They did as well.
I didn't know that. That was a rule. I had to learn that rule in the stadium.
Yeah, it was interesting to see that whole. I personally.
If you were flying, I was like, why? What happened? Did they jump offside? What happened here?
I personally just don't care for the new kickoff rules. I think it's a bit too much.
Greg Schiano had the best kickoff substitution, and we just ignored him. The 4th and 15 punt. We should have just done that. That should have been the kickoff because it's a punt. It's part of football. You could have just done that. No, we had to copy Vince McMahon and do the XFL kickoff.
I don't know why.
Look, don't get me wrong. I think Bass had that the kickoff went out of bounds. I think was the right idea. It's just you can see the wind carried it.
Certainly agree. Like I get what they were trying to do. They were trying to kick it in and roll it into the end zone because that way it will go to the 20.
Yeah, you try to cloth and corner it because even if it stops at the one, now they have to still go get it.
Right.
Like that's what they did the first half, and it worked great. They pinned him at like the 3 yard line. Basically, just said told Carlos.
It's just hard to be you know successful every time with that, especially in the with the conditions the way they were with the wind. I think the way the wind was set up there in the fourth quarter, the Cardinals certainly had the advantage because when you think about it, on the kickoff return touchdown they had, the ball came up short because the wind, you know, pulled it back, and it was, you know, not a super strong kick. The guy was able to run into it. Yes, it was pretty awful tackling for the Bills part. At one point, there was four Bills that were surrounding DJ Dallas, but you know, it is
Greg
what it
Davis,
is. The Bills,
dog, you need to go tackle.
He needs to go just hump the dummy for like 30 minutes.
Listen,
like,
listen, I don't want him to get a single rep of practice on offense this week. He should be running kickoff drills. With
he
Matt
should. He,
all week.
That can't
him
happen.
And Bass should be doing kickoff practice. Don't let him practice offense. They don't need
I
it.
I agree.
There.
Completely agree. So yeah. That pretty much covers it. It was another good episode. We will be recording tomorrow night in preview, obviously on a short week for the Dolphins game. So there's a
I
lot.
I will not be there. Hopefully, my esteemed co-host Mike stops
Michael.
Frying fish and playing basketball enough to come back to our podcast as I go on vacation.
We miss you, Mike. We miss you. We see you left your family, so I hope you feel great about that. Another
almost,
fun one.
Almost as bad as Rodgers leaving his family.
Yeah, almost. Not quite, but it was a pleasure, Trent. We appreciate everybody tuning into this one. Obviously, the links to the TikTok, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, all in the description below. You can check us out on Instagram, anywhere basically that has any recording. You will find us at Views from the Ground.
Anywhere you can get visual and audio consumption. You will
there
find
is.
Either our soothing voices or our handsome faces.
Correct. Thank you. Likewise, Trent. So thanks, everybody, tuning in. This was a fun episode, and take care, and go Bills.
Go Bills.